there truly have been studies by Texas A&M that shows literally that you will heal faster and quicker with being able to see green plants. So we know that really well-designed hospitals, trauma centers, recovery centers always have a view of a green space. We know it because it feels good, right? We just work on our enteric nervous system and we go, oh, it looks so nice, that feels so good. But we really don't pinpoint it and try to put science to it. So there's few universities, Rutgers and Texas A&M have really focused on that as far as environmental design. And so biophilic design is the use of certain types of plants, not only to clean the air, because we've always known that, mm-hmm. but to make us actually feel better, heal, and move on from different traumas, which we know everybody has in different levels.
Hello, hello, everybody. Welcome to Better Together. When you know better, you get better. And you know that's what we try to do here every single day. It is Monday, July 19th, 2021. Our quote of the day, you can't use up creativity. The more you use, the more you have. And that is Maya Angelou. You're on a Maya kick this week, Kelsey.
That's right, I am.
Welcome to our Heal Squad. Thank you guys for being with us. We're coming to you from our West Coast studio here in LA. Of course, we'll be bouncing around, I think, from studio to studio for a while. Just use them all up. Why not?
We have enough of them.
We have enough of them. All right, guys. So
they're costing us nothing but money. Might as well use them.
Kelsey wants to remind me of this, remind you of the schedule. So on the show today and Monday, next Monday?
Monday and Tuesday.
When, which Monday? Next Monday and this, next Tuesday?
So today and Tuesday.
So it says on the show today and Monday.
Oh, today and today.
Today and today. Tuesday. Kelsey, today why don't Tuesday. You do it because you know what you're saying.
Looks like
you.
Someone's got a case of the moon days.
A moon days. All right, you guys. So you get a little Maria today. You get us tomorrow, whoever it may be. And then...
Wait, you get us? We get what, the backup quarterback is back?
The backup quarterback's back, baby.
Nice, with my wing woman.
Okay. That's right.
So me and Kelsey are
tomorrow, correct.
Nice.
And then in August, the first couple weeks of August, you get some more Maria. Little dabble here, little dabble there. Then we have some more incredible reruns at the end of August. Then boom, September, we back, baby.
Mm-hmm. And we are ready to hustle.
Yeah, we're going to have a big team meeting in August. And we were saying on Regular Guy Friday, and on the Patreon show that, any ideas you think you guys have for our fall relaunch, we're super excited. We want to give the show, not a makeover, but definitely we want to do some different things. And we're going to big team meeting in August to figure it out.
We got to be leveling up at all times.
Leveling up,
it's
that
like
jazz.
We've talked about, right? What's the biggest difference, Kelsey, between McDonald's and Burger King? Let's see if she listens.
That McDonald's always is changing. And like keeping up with the times.
Wow.
Look at that. That's
very
my
good.
Girl.
That's very good, girl. Kelsey.
Thank
and
you.
So they're constantly renovating, constantly upgrading. Now, if I was at McDonald's, I would be like, why are you guys spending this money to renovate? It looks good the way it is. That's what I say to Kevin. And Kevin just defies me and goes and does it. And then I'm like, oh my God, this is so much better. By the way.
I'm like, the whole world's crazy for coffee, Maria. We need McCafe.
Yeah. And I'm like, what's he talking about? This is me. Thank God I have him.
Remember 7 years ago, I said,
I would be
I wanna,
Burger King go, if it wasn't for you. Not that I don't level up in life. I level up, but for some reason, when it comes to that stuff.
Well, I think we're good. Yeah, but that's a good team. That's a good team, though, right?
At least I can admit it.
Even though it's not true. Fun. It's not fun, but to be part of it. But the results are usually very good.
Yeah. Well, I also, I'm working on it. I've gotten better. Haven't I?
It's funny. I swear to God, it's a June thing because Stephen and you, you both were, no, because the both of you, it's like, wait, don't you see? I'm presenting evidence as to why if Starbucks and Coffee Bean have all these lines, I said to you like 7 or 8 years ago, really like
Dunkin' Donuts, let's honey. Look at the leveling up of Dunkin' Donuts. Now they've got all these like snack menus
yeah,
and
but
these
even,
new drinks.
But before, but let's stay
the
with
stores
coffee.
Stores look gorgeous. Don't talk to me about Starbucks.
But stay with coffee. Even they moved over from donuts to coffee.
Yeah.
And I was telling you, Maria, these big giant corporations are spending millions of dollars for a reason, not for fun, not because they think it's a cool idea.
Yeah, they're spending so much money on research.
But no matter how much I would present logic to you or to Steven, it's like, no, I don't see it. And so I just said to both of you at some point, just trust. Mm-hmm. Just say, okay, I don't see it, but his results have proven that this is his genius. Now, you know I have many, many, many blind spots in other areas, as we both know. Mm-hmm. But that one thing that happens to be, and you always Kaizen, continuous improvement,
in
Japanese
fact,
philosophy.
What's funny is we're talking about leveling up and kind of renovations and stuff, and that's what we're going to be talking about today with our incredible guest, Kelly Ellis. She's an international celebrity designer, artist, host, speaker, and design psychology expert. So it's funny, when we first met Kelly, she was already part therapist with us.
Yeah.
Part designer.
Yes.
Interesting.
She's one of the most multi-talented women in her field. And we've loved working with her. I always was kind of against working with designers because he just watched these designers, they'd come up, they'd jack up these prices, and it okay. just all right,
we,
go ahead.
You and can we say. Don't need 11 different shades of tan for each different room. So when you would like have a nick in a wall and I'd have to touch it up, I'd be like, wait, what?
Yeah.
Like there were 11 different colors, but 11 different shades and textures of like the one same color. I'm like, this is insanity.
Yeah. So Kelly Sorry. Comes in, she keeps it all simple. She is so frugal and like so great with how she does her work.
Yep.
You may have seen her on TV shows like TLC's Clean Sweep, HGTV's Takeover, My Makeover. She's brilliant. She helped us redesign and renovate our home here many times over, especially the most recent one, where she also played architect at one point too, mm-hmm. which is great.
Yeah.
So we're going to be chatting with her today, which is kind of funny. I didn't even make the connection to what we were talking about just now about kind of leveling up. But yeah, Heel Squad, we want to level up in this next half of this year. You know, this is truly the only time I've ever had where I don't have this kind of heavy responsibility on my shoulders of taking care of my mom and even my dad, because my dad has a caretaker now and, you know, I'm still having to do stuff, but that weight isn't on me like it was. Yeah. And, you know, as I'm recovering and healing and, you know, all of that, I'm eager to kind of jump in the fall and really take this kind of to the next level. Like we always had like a little bit of a brake pad on because we could only do so much.
I mean, Kelsey and I gave it 7 days a week. We did our best.
You guys killed it.
Just the two of us, you know?
And by the way, okay, I don't know percentages pretty well, but we, I think 5X'd our YouTube views.
8X.
Was it 8X?
It was 8.
Oh, shit. Well, see, I told you I didn't know how to do it. I thought I was really good. Okay, so we 8X'd our YouTube views from last summer. And so the show is growing. And, you know, we did that really great Tony Robbins business mastery class last year where he talked to us and taught us that you can't manage what you can't measure.
Right.
And so measurements are really important. We've been pretty lame at them. Across the board and in all of our companies. And now we're trying to get better at that. And so I think when you see that, you're like, okay, we're headed in the right direction. And yes, you know, do I wish we were further along in the journey? That'd be great. I'd wish we had 1 million subscribers on YouTube, yeah, but we are growing. I think it's a great example for everybody out there who is doing their thing. It's like, listen, we're crawling till we can walk.
And what's still the most important thing?
Every year we get better.
And no, even more important that the health and well-being of your loved ones.
Yes.
And we tended to that.
Yep,
and
we did.
We came out of it. We're still standing and, you know, obviously.
She's going to put the fix in on the other side.
Absolutely.
Watch this fire.
I mean, I'm telling you, but I will say like for a lot of people, Maria, you know, first of all, how do we finish years, Maria? We finish what?
Strong.
Always finish strong.
Yep.
Like no matter what you do, guys,
see,
like sports,
I know my answers
everything,
too, Kelsey.
You finish strong. And so this is a time for people. I always feel like the summer, yes, relax, recalibrate, but just like the new year is like a milestone. I feel like the summer to the fall, fall's like go back to school.
Oh,
the,
yeah. Hustle starts.
Right? Everything.
It's no joke.
So this is the time, you know, like.
So I'm trying to prepare Queenie. I'm like, Queenie, we are not going at like 40% anymore. Like we're going to go at 120. Yeah,
so this is the time.
You better get ready.
But for everybody right now, this is a really good time to start preparing for like, okay, by December, like even Roxy, who you know, we work with, she's going to end the year. Hopefully she's wanted to act her whole life. And she's going to end the year by the end of the year with 2 movies that she's going to be starring mm-hmm. in. And it's like. And for Kelsey and I, we have our milestones that we want to achieve from now with the show until
December. To not have Regular Guy Friday get canceled by me?
Well, we've... two more shows. It's 25, and then the box set, we're done.
Box set comes out at 25, Maria.
We're done.
Fun fact, not saying what I was doing yesterday, but I did work on the most insanely amazing project, and Rob Lowe was also there. And just fun fact,
he liked Regular Guy Friday?
He loves Regular Guy Friday. He's a huge fan.
Yep.
He was telling the director, because the director came over to me and was like, Rob Lowe just said that you have the best laugh ever. I was like, yay.
It's true.
Anyway, as I giggle.
But you got to have some, you know what, Maria? You got to have some joy.
Yeah.
At that project. It's not a money play, right?
So
it's more
fun.
Passion.
Yeah.
But think of the joy you felt. And I was saying, like, we can have more of that, mm-hmm. but we have to work for it.
So, all right. So here's the thing. Heel Squad, if you have any suggestions for us, please share them with us so that we can get better together.
Maria, can you remind them to tell a friend about us and to please give us a 5-star rating?
Yes. Kevin said, I remind you.
On
and
Apple
I ask
Podcast
you.
Because it's very important.
So I want to talk about one quick thing before we get into our interview with Kelly. So I saw this yesterday and I was like, oh my God, I knew it. I knew sunscreens were terrible for you, right? I know they're good for us too. Trust me, I use them. But I use organic ones.
Zinc, baby.
And I have always been terrified of them, thinking about the fact that I'm outside boiling hot, my pores are open, and now I'm spraying this shit on there. It's just like the bug sprays and stuff. I'm like, oh my God, I'm putting off on my body. It sounds so horrible. I did it the other day because I was desperate and there was nothing else around, but then I showered immediately after. Pharmacies... Well, not just pharmacies, but on Wednesday, Johnson & Johnson issued a voluntary recall for some of their sunscreens. Mm-hmm. Neutrogena Beach Defense, Cool Dry Sport, Invisible Dry, and Ultra Sheer. And Aveeno Protect and Refresh. So they noted that internal testing identified low levels of benzene in some of their products. So benzene is used in I think it's oils and detergents and all kinds of things like that, paint. And they found it. And so out of an abundance of caution, while they investigate, they have pulled these items. So benzene, at first I want you to know, I thought this was like, oh, see, sunscreens are terrible for you. It's not that necessarily. So benzene is actually not an ingredient in sunscreens in general. It never has been. It's not supposed to be anywhere near sunscreen manufacturing. It just somehow got in there. Now, it wasn't in all of them, but it was in some. And so they had to pull all of them just to be safe. So the short answer they say of how it got there is we really can't be sure. And you can't make blanket rules or assumptions as to how this happened other than looking at the facts. So, just to make sure that nobody's like panicking officially, but I do think... there's another fun fact in here. So, someone I worked with had found out that one of J-Lo's secrets to her glow was Neutrogena Ultra Sheer Mist.
Nice.
So a couple times when we remembered, we used it and I was like, oh my God. And then the cap broke off and I never got to use it again. Maybe it was like a sign.
Totally.
God was like smiling on me.
I like J-Lo being a regular girl.
Oh no. Yeah, for sure. So
she's got like $100,000 saved in the bank.
Definitely. Maybe 105.
Yeah.
She's
a saver.
But definitely, I think if you have these bottles at home, it's worth it to throw them away. We don't want carcinogens in our bodies till they figure it out. And I know they will. And then from there, maybe in the meantime, you look at some of these other organic products like Kula. And even CVS is carrying them now, so it's easier to find rather than having to go to Sephora.
Definitely. You just want to look for zinc. That should be your only sunscreen ingredient is zinc.
Really?
Uh-huh.
That's the really white stuff, though.
Yep.
No, but I don't like that. I like sprays.
Well, yeah, but you can still get zinc sprays. Yeah, no, it does come on kind of like it leaves you casty for a little bit.
Yeah. it is not a good look, unfortunately.
I'll leave it on for like 5 minutes, then it's gone.
Okay. So maybe you like sunscreen prior to human seeing you.
Exactly. You gotta prep.
All right. Let's get into our interview with Kelly. Of course, like I said, she's an internationally renowned celebrity designer, and she, of course, has done our home. We're going to chat with her about that process, and I mean, she knows us well at this point. It's been years. Kelly, are you there?
I am.
Hi.
Hi.
All the way from Spain, España.
España, from Barcelona, with love.
Now, do you say Barcelona or do you say Barcelona?
You know, it depends. It's a very international group here. So if you're from South America, they say Barcelona like we do. But if you want to pretend like you're local, put the lisp in there a little bit.
Kelly, I am so grateful to you. So here's the deal, guys. We met Kelly, oh my God, how many years ago was that now?
Oh, maybe 7.
Yeah. And so my mom, my dad, and Kevin decided to take a sledgehammer to the kitchen and not have any plans. And so we had no windows, no doors for like almost a year. We had plastic black bags for windows. Okay. How long was it?
2 months.
It felt like a really long time.
2 months.
Okay.
No, it wasn't that long. It was you calling quickly. It would have gone longer, I think.
Yeah.
I think it would have gone longer, but it was you going, "Hey, no, we can't do this anymore."
So I go, "We need help." So I 911'd, got to Kelly. Kelly comes over and she was like, "We're going to get through this. Do not worry." And she was such a calming force. And she came up with a plan. She found this great guy to come in and, you know, give us some sketches for cabinets and you know, a design and a flow. And, you know, you're just so good at what you do. You make it so easy. And that was kind of our first project. Then we had like little mini ones in between. You helped me decorate my office or like figure that out. Like I'll just text her and be like, "Do you like this? What do I do with this? Does this work?" It's like when you're getting dressed for an event, you're like, you want your girlfriends to like approve of your outfit or something. And so sometimes it'll be like that. But then we had another massive renovation we wanted to do. And that was going to be 5 years ago. And we were going to redo our master bathroom and suite and all of that. And she and I are going back and forth. And our architect, who was giving us our final draft, the contractor was ready to go. We were going to do it that June or maybe that July. I don't remember what it was. Yeah. It was that summer. And yeah, he ghosted us. And I said, "Wait, Kelly, I think something's wrong. I don't think this is supposed to happen right now." Well, of course, my mom got diagnosed. Then we found out his dad had been diagnosed with a rapid decline of ALS. So I was like, okay, thank God we listened to the universe. We didn't try to push it through. That would have been a horrible time to do it. So then in the interim, with all that time, we had more breakthroughs on what we wanted to do and how we wanted to do it. And we did some shifteroo-ing. Right? Like, I actually wonder, guys, if my parents' bedroom, that whole thing wasn't an addition back in the day, because those are the only bedrooms that didn't have bathroom suites. Mm-hmm. Think about it. My parents had their room and the bathroom was across the hall, but how come the other bedrooms were suites?
Right.
That might have been an addition.
Probably. And I mean, it's good that we took the time we did, because it did change so many times. And then the final result was almost like a duh moment, you know, because
yeah,
at first, when you start thinking about the remodel, you get really, really ambitious.
Right? Yes.
Well, move this and move that and change this and change that. And the final layout was just the most obvious and the most, but the best flow.
It yeah,
just always comes out that
well,
way.
Then again, it was like, I left for Connecticut and Kevin was like, "She's gone." Sledgehammer comes back out. And instead of moving the bathroom, which would have meant moving the pipes and getting permits and all that, we made it a cosmetic makeover. But we'll get into that a little bit, but tell me a little bit, or tell everyone a little bit, Kelly, about what you do and how you do it with your clients.
Interesting. Well, it's changed a bit, as you can imagine, since I've moved overseas, and we'll talk about why. And
didn't
why
hurt us one bit. Three,
I
how
know.
Many 6,000 miles? Well, no, it's a lot more miles. And we did it all over that. WhatsApp.
it was really interesting because, you know, before this last crazy year, before 2020, and I would try to explain to people that we really can do all of this remotely. You know, as much as you traveled anyway, we did it remotely, mm-hmm. all of it, always every project, right? Yep. I was in Orange County at the time, you were in LA or traveling. And so we always kind of had to do things on the fly. Then, you know, fast forward 2020, everybody's doing things remotely. That's just the way it is, digital world. And I use digital products anyway, right? So the space planning tools and all the things were digital anyway. So it didn't hurt us much. we just kept going. You know, it wasn't a big deal for us because we were used to the flow. But I think now everyone understands that it can be done this way. So I still work with a hospitality group that I've been designing for in the States. And it's always been digital again, right? So each of these projects are in Oregon, they're in Northern California, there's some in Colorado, and I've always done them digitally. And so nothing's really changed. And thank goodness people have kind of come around to that process. But to answer your question, there's a lot of questions. I try to do the design psychology, you know, behind the scenes to ask, why are we doing this design? What's important? You know, what styles do you like if you two are a couple like you guys with different tastes and different, you know, I love this, I hate it. You know, it's really interesting to me to listen to a couple, and you guys were great. You didn't have too much of this, but
you can be honest, don't worry.
I know, right? It's real interesting to see like the visceral reaction to even a lamp, you know, like just the most basic things you would think. And one person says, I love it. The other one says, I hate it. So, you know, you got to understand why and what it is we're aiming for. You know, we're trying to eliminate the trends and go for what feels right. And there's all kinds of questions. So that's part of the process. And then of course the actual designing process is easy compared to that. getting through the therapy side of the design is the harder part. The design itself is actually pretty easy.
Because as easygoing as Kevin is, remember when we were like, we're taking your office and we're making it a closet. And he was like, what, where am I going to go? What do you mean? I'm like, honey, like, hello, we need it. Well, now he has his closet, his office, and he has a closet, so he's happy. But you know, that was a very, very tough time. He hated us secretly.
Honestly, I'm sure. And Kevin was so funny about it. I mean, there were some literally crying, laughing moments at Kevin and his response to a lot of this stuff. And, you know, at midnight text between you and I, and then, you know, drop the bomb on him really early. Tell him he's not going to have an office or he's not going to have, you know. But yeah, we work through it. But there is a process because, you know, there's everyone in the house, to your point, at the time. We were designing for parents and guests and, you know,
babies and
you name it. I mean, there's so many different aspects.
Handicapped, accessible. Yeah. Like there were so many things that we're planning for. We're going to do this once. We got to get it done. We want to have space for kids and, you know, two, and then they're going to need a play area. Like, where are they going to play? And we're going to need, you know, a space, you know, my mom's going to be handicap accessible. Now we got to make things handicap accessible and zero entry bathroom. And
so many factors to consider. And I think a lot of households are like that, obviously. And if you're fortunate, you can have your family with you and you need to account for those things. But we, as we also have learned last year, we require a lot of our homes.
Yeah. Right? So how has that changed your business when you're working with people now?
A lot. I used to, you know, jump up and down and scream, you know, talking about form and function because I would have clients that would want the beautiful settee that looks beautiful, but is terribly uncomfortable.
What's a settee?
I'm sorry, a very fancy sofa.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So there would be things where people would like, you know, they would like the form over the function. Mm-hmm. And now that we have spent so many hours and so much time in our homes, everyone understands, wow, okay, this kitchen island does need to do 97 things. And wow, this dining room table space that we created as just a dining room, not anymore. You know, I can't tell you how many dining rooms I've converted to yoga studios over the course of 2020.
Wow. Or an office. We were using our dining room in Connecticut as an office where we could all sit with our laptops.
Exactly. 100%. And so, yeah, things have changed a lot. People really looked at their homes in a different way. And what was really interesting besides the need for different spaces was the feel of the space. Mm-hmm. Now we always knew that, you know, how the room feels was super important, but how does a room feel for 18 hours a day? let's talk about that. You know, what's the paint color? What are the materials? We're bringing biophilic design, meaning we're bringing the outdoors in as much as possible.
Yes.
Right. Creating havens and being respite, being able to find little nooks and corners that we could create where people were really, truly together a lot, you know, with kids in school and homeschooling. And it was crazy. And people needing, you know.
Can you go into, was it biophilic?
Biophilic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, can you go into that a little bit?
Of course. Yeah. It's part of the design psychology program, and we'll talk about that. But it's something that I just am so passionate about. I was introduced to it a couple of years ago, being the spokesperson for the Society of American Florists. And we all know the power of a flower, but I never knew all of the science behind it.
Oh, give us the science. Yes. I'm so excited.
The science is fantastic, but there truly have been studies by Texas A&M that shows literally that you will heal faster and quicker with being able to see green plants. So we know the really well-designed hospitals, trauma centers, recovery centers always have a view of a green space. We know it because it feels good, right? We just work on our enteric nervous system and we go, oh, it looks so nice. That feels so good. But we really don't pinpoint it and try to put science to it. So there's a few universities, Rutgers and Texas A&M, have really focused on that as far as environmental design. And so biophilic design is the use of certain types of plants, not only to clean the air, because we've always known that, but to make us actually feel better, heal, and move on from different traumas, which we know everybody has in different levels.
Real or fake? Does it matter?
No, it actually doesn't.
Okay.
Good. It actually doesn't. No. I mean, if you want to clean the air, clearly real.
Yeah.
But if you are talking about the way it makes you feel, obviously you can't look at a terrible artificial plant and think, God, that's a terrible artificial plant, because your first reaction and within a second is that needs to go. But when there are some beautiful artificial plants or preserved plants that they have, you know, some of the ferns and some of the pines are well preserved. Some of the larger trees are well preserved. It has the same feeling. And of course, you know, hotels in Las Vegas know this very well, right? So you walk into some of the lobbies and you feel like you're outdoors.
Yeah.
They've created some incredible spaces where you feel like you can take a nice fresh breath of air. Forget that you're in a casino.
Which
lobby,
one is it that has the botanical garden inside? Is it MGM?
Bellagio has a garden.
That one. One of them had the most amazing installations and you're just so blown away by it.
Yes. They have the art gallery and the installations and they change them and they're stunning.
Wow.
But that is, everyone knows the power of the flowers and the greenery. So, you know, it seems fancy to add biophilic, you know, a fancy name to it, but there is true science behind it.
I know it makes me so happy. Like I was saying, even up on the balcony, it would be great to have something green up there.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
And in the bedroom right now, there's like this old fake palm tree that I had in my office that's in there. It doesn't fit the vibe. It needs like more of like a fig leaf kind of thingy or whatever.
Yes, you do.
But the one I have in the dining room is really beautiful, or the living room is really beautiful. Just, it makes everything feel good. That's why I feel like we love, when we bought this house, the first thing when I saw the front yard, it was all orange or citrus trees. I was like, this. And when you're looking out the bay windows and you're looking at all these citrus trees, you feel so good. But I didn't know there was like true science behind that. I go to Dimitri's apartment, and inside he's got so many plants. And I always feel good when I go in there. And sometimes I'm like, wow, there's a lot of plants in here, but it feels really good.
I just thought that was being Greek. So I don't know. My Greek family always have plants all over the place, right?
Yeah.
Up the walls and all over the place. But I mean, to look at the setting that you've created behind you, right? Because you know that that's part of—
Oh, shit. Yeah.
Yeah. It's what makes you feel better and also makes people feel better when they look at it. So that your house has that, but also think of all of the huge picture windows that we put in the back.
Yep.
So you can see all the greenery that you have in the backyard as well.
Yeah.
So you have that outside in, you are truly living that biophilic design for sure.
Wow. Okay. Talk design psychology officially. Yeah. Obviously that's part of it.
Yeah, it is a big part. I wrote a book 8 years ago now called Do I Look Skinny in This House? And it was very a really light version of design psychology because I was always so fascinated with the whys of design, more of the how-tos, right? Because everybody has their own take and you hire a designer for their filter, right? Pretty much.
I like that. You hire a designer for their filter. I always thought you hire a designer because you don't know what the fuck you're doing and you want it to look good.
Yeah.
It's another way to look at it, right?
Yeah, that is true. It's totally true.
Or you're terrified your taste is going to suck or you're like, and you know what, actually, I think the other reason we want someone to help us is because we don't have the balls ourselves. Like I'm nervous to mix colors and patterns. I mean, I've learned along the way with you, right? How to get stronger in these areas. Because when I sit here and I watch you and I just see you effortlessly be like, no, this is great. This is great. We'll take those bar lights and we'll flip them and they'll be long. I see that there are no rules.
Right.
And I think for us as, you know, the civilians in this design world, we're like, oh my God, there's gotta be rules and I'm going to ruin them and I'm going to break them.
Yeah, no. And that's also really important too. But see, different designers will have a different filter. So there are some designers that think there are rules and that's okay. So you go through and you find the one that aligns with you most and then you move forward. But I think now that people can shop on their own, you know, the days of interior design where you had to hire a designer to buy furniture is pretty much over. So what you're really hiring the designer for is their aesthetic, right? Mm-hmm. Their filter, their way of putting together, you know, 20 items in a room versus someone else's way of doing that. So that's kind of the new approach to interior design and the business itself. But I always was fascinated by the people and why they surrounded themselves with certain things. Like think about your front living room and the items that you have there and what mm-hmm. meaning, everything has a meaning, right? Yep. And it's super important to you. And you have curated that space mm-hmm. just for you and Kev. Like it is, everything has a meaning, has its place and it's highlighted for a certain reason. It's neutral palette. It is probably the most perfect example in your, well, not the only, but one of the most perfect examples of design psychology in that space, because you have thoughtfully placed everything.
Yeah. They're meaningful pieces. Like my dad's shoes from the village made out of tire, or, you know, my WWE belt or travels, artifacts I've gone for my travels, family pictures. It is a collection of the most important things in my life, I guess.
And so designers who are aware of that and understand how to design around things that mean things, and then going really deep. So design psychology starts off with the history. You know, you can imagine if you have a client who has a home, doesn't feel really comfortable in it, can't understand why, but they also have grandma's furniture in there that they didn't have a great childhood. There's not a lot of great memories, but they're recreating a space with furniture that is not serving them anymore because of deep-seated memories that they're not realizing are very much tied to certain elements and certain pieces. I have many times gone into spaces where I have to ask, tell me what this piece means to you. Why is this here? Well, I inherited from a deceased relative, but you know, I had a terrible childhood. Okay. We need to cleanse. We need to go back. We need to edit a lot of things. And so
is facelifting it enough? Like if it's a piano or something, can you paint it? Or a chair, can you paint it and make it, give it a new, okay.
In fact, I have a great example. I worked with a client who was recently divorced, very bitter about it. and she has the house. It was her house to begin with, but she has the house, but now it's got his quote unquote stuff or things he picked out in it. And she was really mad because she had this pool table that she loved to use and loved to play. But it was his, and she was just mad, you know, angry. And she, every time I saw her, she had on purple. And I said, today, you're going to go home. You're going to call somebody to refelt and recover that pool table in purple felt and then come back to me. I cannot tell you the minute it happened that she made this pool table purple and her color, her thing, she called me up in tears. She's like, it's mine. This is my house again. It's my space. Something so, so simple. So simple. But we need to think about, you know, why we choose the things, why we surround ourselves with certain things. And that's where design psychology starts. And then it feeds into color therapy. It feeds into function, flow, and feel. It's lighting. Lighting's huge.
Lighting is everything. Everything.
It really is. And you realize that if we chose or picked different things for, say, your bathroom recently, yes. right? As a great example, it would completely change the entire look. Yeah. Like that fast.
Totally.
It'd be a completely different space. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, remember, like, we went through so many different phases with the bathroom of different kind of chandeliers. And I just knew I wanted like a crystal glam chandelier. And so, and you know, we worked with Lamps Plus. I went on the website, I picked, you know, for everything. And I would say, Kelly, what do you think of this one? She's like, yeah, I like that one. I'm like, okay, cool. I like it too. And okay, so, and even the light bars, we weren't here when a lot of this was getting finalized because we were back east with my mom. So when Francisco installed the light bars, instead of having them go across, and by the way, we had already installed all the mirror. So now you're screwed. You can't just switch it, patch it or whatever. So, he put them the long way and I go, huh, those look really good. Actually, Kelly did that in my other bathroom. This looks really good. And it ended up giving the vibe that you had initially wanted. She was going to hang those drop light pendants. Yeah. And I think it ended up being better because it's a narrow galley bathroom.
Right.
And I liked that it's clear. It doesn't have the drops. Another fun fact, and I actually learned this from our friend Barb Lee, who you know because they've been involved in our renovations too.
Yeah.
Mirroring, someone on my Instagram was like, a lot of mirrors. I'm like, dude, I'm not, that's not why.
It's for space. Come on now.
Yeah. So explain how mirroring can make a difference in a room.
Well, it's so funny because it was such a trend in the 60s and 70s to mirror things, right? And it was an antique mirror.
Yeah.
And people tore it down. They didn't like it anymore. But we use it all the time and people don't realize how strategic it can be. But for a galley bathroom like you have, where you put mirror on both sides, you lose all sense of walls, all sense of where things stop and end. The light bounces around. The artificial light bounces around. The sunlight bounces around. There's no hard edges or it opens up the space incredibly. You can make a mistake. Actually, you kind of have to go for it in a space like that. You either do it or you don't.
Yep.
Because if you had just one mirror, then it really sticks out, right? You've got this like beacon that's reflecting all the sunlight. So if you only had one mirror, say over the tub or something, that would stand out like a sore thumb, right? Two little mirrors over each sink and then one on the other side. No, because you're not reflecting enough light. You're just highlighting the fact that the two walls are close together. Mm-hmm. That's what you're doing, right? You're actually emphasizing the fact that the walls are closer together. But if you mirror the whole thing, now there's no boundaries.
Yeah.
Nothing. It just is so open. It's not that you need to see yourself in every angle. It's because we're actually utilizing the space and the sunlight and getting rid of the walls.
Yeah. I mean, I was in the tub last night and I was so happy with all the mirrors because I have like 50 massive chandeliers in there in the smallest space ever because it's bouncing everywhere. And I was like, oh, this is so good.
And it does double and triple your light. Remember I was telling you that before, like if you hang a pendant or put a light right in front of a mirror, you've doubled it. Now, if you have six of them, you actually have 12 lights.
Yeah.
And so you're not losing any light. You don't need to go crazy with them. Yep. You could put four lights up there, but you actually have eight.
Yeah. More. The other thing about lighting is so crazy. So my old closet, I was having a lot of lighting issues in there. And so when I was designing the new one with California Closets, they were talking about all the interior lighting they do inside. And I said, okay, whatever you do, I need this thing lit up like a Christmas tree. It's got to be so freaking bright. And luckily they did. And it looks insane. We also added the canister lights and that massive other chandelier I got from Lamps Plus. Now with that one, I went a little edgier, which was fun.
It looks great though. And it's functional no matter what time of day. Right?
Yeah. But my old closet, my biggest issue was the lighting and we added canisters. That wasn't enough. I got another chandelier. Not enough. Yesterday, Kevin goes in and what did you do?
I changed over from the halogens, which if you have halogens, I just urge everyone get off them. They use up tons of energy and they emit so much heat. You'll literally burn your fingers on it. I finally changed all the canisters over to LED and we have way brighter light and no heat.
I was like, for 16 years, I'm sitting in there like suffering in hot. It was heat and no light. And I didn't know. By the way, light bulbs are like brain surgery to me. It is so complicated. When I
know.
Like, we went to the Lamps Plus outlet on a last minute when we were driving by it, and I was finishing up the first floor bathroom that I decided last minute to like redo. We had some water damage and stuff. I was like, let's just do this whole thing over. And I went in there to find a chandelier. And I found the coolest chandelier for so cheap.
I love them.
Kelsey, will you pull up the picture? I'll show you that first floor bathroom because I don't know if I've sent you. Okay, so that is the master bath. And that's the crazy ass amazing chandelier that we got from Lamps Plus that I love.
But you can see where the mirrors made the room, Kelly, thanks to you, the mirrors make the room look so much larger than it is.
And if you go to the next picture, so those cabinets... we wanted floating. Remember we talked about doing floating so that it felt bigger in there.
Can you explain floating for audio?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Kelly, you can do it.
Sure. I'll do it.
Thank you, Kelly.
Go, Kelly.
Even if it's attached to the back, floating cabinets are just literally from anywhere from 4 to 6 to 8, sometimes 10 or more inches off the ground from the front. So it just doesn't have the footprint. It doesn't feel like a big chunky.
It doesn't have legs. In other words, it doesn't.
No.
Right.
No legs. It doesn't touch the ground in front like most cabinets do. So even if you elevate that space and it looks like it's floating, sometimes it doesn't have to be. It could be completely attached on the back of the cabinet, but the front of the cabinet, when you walk in, if it doesn't touch the ground, it doesn't feel like it's taking up that footprint, which is so deceiving, but it changes the entire feel.
It feels more spacious.
It does. It does because you think you have visual space and it just feels better to stand in front of it. You know, you don't feel like you're going to hit your feet or it's uncomfortable. It gives you an illusion. And that's true of a lot of furniture for any space, actually.
The other thing that's really important that you tell me when we were designing the new closet too, was really looking at what you have and planning for what you have. And then also knowing, are we going to get rid of stuff? So, I mean, I took out, I think it was 10 massive trash bags of stuff out of the old closet. Dimitri came in. We were ruthless. Nope.
Yeah.
But for the bathroom, I was really thinking about, okay, I want a deep hair drawer so that I can do all my brushes, all my tools, have the plug inside, which I still haven't gotten that little unit where you put the tools in, but I will. And I went to the Container Store and I got with Dimitri... I was like, I need help. This is too much for my brain to handle right now. So we got these like plastic inserts that hold everything so well. I might have a picture of that. I don't know, Kelsey. You can take a look. That's me and Kelly from our first renovation. We used your tile for the backsplash of the stove.
Cuties.
That was when you had long hair.
I know. It looked like yours.
Yep. Okay. Let's see. What else do we have here?
That's it. I don't see any containers.
No other pictures?
We'll have to throw them up.
Okay, I'm going to send you the pictures of the bathroom downstairs because I want to show you.
And Kelly, for lighting, you know, when Maria's talking about being confused about bulbs, I tend, for makeup and just going to filmmaking, I like to use daylight bulbs, you know, and you can see if you look on any package, there's daylight, there's soft light. I know there's different things, but would you agree it's daylight if you want for makeup and
100%. Yeah. Okay. Full spectrum light. So, and you'll see a little rainbow sort of on the packaging. And I mean, we use that even to combat seasonal affective disorder. You cannot beat the full spectrum light. But for color and all of that, because if you don't want to pull cool, right. Especially if you are trying to use it for makeup and getting ready and everything tends to be bluish, right? And not, you don't have a good natural color. You leave the space looking extremely bronze because you're trying to compensate for blue light. And vice versa, right? You don't want to go too warm because then it's just also false.
So, because I know the warm and the cooling might be confusing to people, Kelly, but when the bulbs that are a little bit more orange to just, you know, take it to more civilian. When would you opt for that versus the white, bright white light of daylight bulb?
The bright, like the cool, bright. That's hard. It depends. That's for task lighting. Okay. So when you want to create more of a soft mood and you want to say in a reading room or a room where you're trying to create a sense of calm, a yoga room, meditation room, a child's room, even the dining room. You want warmer light, more yellow, more
warmer is yellow. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. More yellow looking bulbs.
Got it.
Right. And so when you're doing task lighting, sometimes it's cooking because you want to see the real color of the food, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes cooking with makeup, getting dressed, doing things where it's, you know, minimal, doesn't require a essential mood. It just, you need to be able to see what you're doing. That's when you want to go to more of a cooler tones, the whiter white bulbs.
Got it. I just sent Kelsey the pictures. Have you loaded them up?
They're coming.
Okay.
I'm sending them to my Slack. I'll let you know.
So what about when you're designing your closet? I know a lot of people want the glam closet. A lot of people aren't going to have an entire room to do it. Do you have any hacks on the best way to go about doing that?
Mirrors. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, me and my mirrors, I absolutely love them, but, I know people love their Pinterest and they love to do some searching. So if anybody wants to search small glam closets, I guarantee you're going to run into cabinet doors that have mirrors on them.
Yeah. We put them on ours too.
Uh-huh.
Those were my way of like getting the full length mirror. And I actually made it so, oh, I forgot I did this. You did this.
Yes.
I wanted my tri-fold mirror so that I can see all sides or if I'm doing a fitting or whatever. I forgot that the doors do that. I have three doors there. Oh, that's hilarious. Okay.
Yes, you do.
Hold that thought.
Most people want to create that space. And so, you know, don't be afraid of the mirrors. It's not a trendy thing. It's not a terrible thing. Some people are so afraid of them or they think they're going to be costly, which they're really not. Even if you had existing cabinet doors and you want to mirror the insides, it is so much bang for the buck.
Yeah,
to call somebody and have them come and just measure that space, cut them, install them. It adds instant glam, and then again the space, right? So it's such a win-win always. And then of course your lighting. We've talked about it many times. So if you have anything that shows visually, you can always convert a can to a chandelier if you have that opportunity. Don't forget that. People think they're stuck with a can light and they can't put in a chandelier.
Yeah.
Where there are actual kits that fit into the light bulb fixture that makes it a drop down. You can actually convert can to a pendant light. There's all kinds of quick inexpensive tricks to do that if you don't have a whole room to convert and you want to change up your space. Yeah. Speaking of Container Store, they've got an incredible systems. The Alpha system is one of my favorites. I used to do a TV show and we used Container Store and the Alpha system religiously.
Yeah.
Because they were so great.
And the thing is like, you know, there are the people who are good at DIY and then there are people who aren't. And we are good at DIY and we did do our closet before, but this time I enlisted the help of California Closets because we were doing way too much and we were under a lot of duress with my mom. And I'm so grateful because it was the best money spent. Yes. It really was because it is exactly what I wanted, exactly how I wanted it. And it is giving me endless joy. So I will say if you have a small space, it's actually probably even more important than you enlist a professional to help you with it because you're going to have someone who has that eye that can really design the space optimally for you. Right. And so it's one of those things that it's like the investment piece, right? It's like when you look at your wardrobe, you want to have like some of those pieces that are like your investment pieces. This is an investment. So I want to show you the bathroom. This is how it ended up turning out. So, we kept it white. It used to be black. That tile was there. But go to the chandelier picture, Kelsey. So cool ass chandelier. Go into Lamps Plus. I think I got this at the outlet for like $200 and the bar, the light bar over the little counter. And did we get the mirror there too?
No, again, use of mirrors. We had those installed. Okay. That mirror installed.
Oh no, that mirror got installed, but the little one over the sink.
We actually got it at Lamps Plus.
At Lamps Plus outlet. So obviously you have lampsplus.com. That's where we got a lot of the other chandeliers, but Lamps Plus Outlet has furniture there. They've got mirrors. They've got all kinds of things. I love a sale. So I was really excited. we were driving down the street. We were doing something else that day with Steven. I forget what we were doing. And I go, shit, I need a chandelier. We got to stop in here. And so that was on sale and it was so cute. The only thing I think we did wrong was the sink. I think it looks a little commercial.
Really?
Yeah, we go back to another picture.
Can I ask my expert, please?
I have been regretting it after I've looked at it.
Before Kevin has to do more work.
We did it last minute because we had guests coming over and we needed our guest bathroom to be done. And Kevin ran out and he just like picked it out.
Kelsey, can you go to the other shot, please? And one more behind.
There we go.
There's nothing commercial.
You like that?
A sink is a sink. For me, okay, so you can go crazy with sinks, right? So that the focus is not the sink. So what happens, I think, with a lot of people when they get in their design, and I'm going to tell everybody right now, Maria is definitely fallen into this trap. That I call it too close to the TV trap, right? So if, I'm going to age myself, but when you used to, as a kid, be really close to the television set, there would be little teeny tiny dots. So you would see the little pixelated dots and that's all you see. You don't see the big picture. You're looking at things super, super finitely, mm-hmm. right? And when you back up, you're like, oh, it looks great. You've done the things that are distracting, that no one's looking at the sink when they walk in, unless it was purple and marble and underlit or onyx, or you go really extreme so that that's the focal point.
Ah.
Create focal points in other ways. And you've done it with your lighting. So that's the deal, right? And then sometimes for such small spaces like that, people really go overboard. In my opinion, this is my filter. In my opinion, and you put too many focal points in a small space and you're like, oh my God, what happened in here?
Yeah.
Like there's just too much going on. So it's not, if you wanted to change up anything to make it splashier, you would change the faucet. And that would be the easiest way without Kevin having to get out the sledgehammer.
Thank you.
You're welcome, dear.
Again.
I always have you in mind.
Again. Well, it was a small room. So notice how it's open, you know, because for what you said, it was a tiny room.
Yeah, there was a pedestal sink
and
there before. I liked the pedestal.
And I didn't want to put up any towel racks. So underneath can be a basket of rolled towels if we want to. Okay. But and today, Kelly, for me with sinks, they're so affordable to plug and play. So get 5 or 10 years out of it. You know, I don't even want to say how little amount of money these are.
Say
these things. It was like $200 and something. You know what I mean? Right. Like probably even about 200. So it's like, right, get 5 years out of it. We're happy. You know, plug another one in. And then the other like tip that I did, Kelly, on this, which is probably too inside baseball, was because the bottom is open and some of the plumbing was exposed, I actually took a piece of white acrylic.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you can see in the picture. Yeah. And because
I walked in, I go, this looks terrible. And then he goes, oh shit. And he came out and he got acrylic and he covered
it. Yeah. And I have two holes. So the, you know, just to let the, chrome, pipe underneath, we replaced the pipe. So it'd be chrome. So it could be a feature of that scene, but yeah, I just use the white acrylic backsplash and no one can see the difference. So thank you for saying that.
Okay. You're welcome. But to your point, if you wanted to change out the faucets and find something really cool and flashy, even something as a color, what have you, that's where you add the jewelry, so to speak, of the room, right?
Yeah.
Because the sink is not that big of a deal, but if you decided to redo it and make it a color or something that you really want to focus on, and you can do that.
But you're cool, right, because everyone who comes in is like, I love this chandelier. And I'm always like, it's so cheap.
They're looking at the light.
It looks amazing, but it was so inexpensive. I was like, sweet.
Those are the best deals always. But that's my point, right? So they didn't walk in going, I love your sink. No, they love the sink when it's, you know, hand carved and rough hewn and came from, you know, I don't know, you know, some mountaintop somewhere. Then okay, then you feature the sink and that's what you do. But not in a small space like that.
So Kelly, when you are giving advice to people who want to like recreate a space, I know there are so many ways digitally for people to kind of now, like remember back when we were first doing our first renovation, I'm like, why isn't there an app where I can like put the pieces in and see what this is going to look like, because some of us don't have vision like me.
Right. Well, there are a lot of apps now. I mean, honestly, when we started, it was the beginning of so many things. I personally use an app called Room Styler, and that's what I did the 3Ds for you. And because I love it, because it's zero learning curve. This is for the everyday person who loves to just create room spaces and loves design and wants to design things and doesn't want to learn SketchUp for the next 9 months, or because there's a million apps out there now that you can go and plug in different pieces of furniture. I mean, I think even Wayfair has their own internal now. So everyone's getting on board with being able to create spaces where you take a picture with your phone of your room, and then you pop in that particular chair and you can see what it's going to look like. It's not foreign or expensive or difficult to find by any stretch. I mean, there's even games where you design rooms, right? But when we started, not so much. And people do like, I mean, they love that. When I first started doing online design, right, which is essentially this, 15 years ago, people were like, oh, that's crazy. Nobody's going to do digital design. No one's going to buy a sofa online. No one's going to, because it was different, right? Yeah. We also didn't buy shoes online either. That was outrageous. So we have changed what we do and what we accept, and even the amount of money that we will spend online. So, and it's not unusual to find many of the furniture sites and many of the home shopping sites where you can put in pictures of your own space and put in those items, because they take 3D pictures of them. They pop them in. It's super simple. Room Styler is one of them, but I'm super happy to give you other ones. I just happen to use that because so there's no learning curve.
One that if you give it the space and you say, I want a bedroom, it'll just put something together for you and then you can just buy everything?
No.
That's where you need Kelly.
Yeah. At some point, you got to have some input in there. Yeah. It's not going to go. We haven't created it yet, but maybe we should. Based on all of your Pinterest boards, Maria.
Oh, my
God.
Here's
your new bedroom, right?
Yes. That would be amazing. Well, I'll tell you. So we were selling a property and it wasn't moving in this climate. And I go, something's not right here. It wasn't marketed properly. We redid the marketing. And then I said, let's stage it. Because I just know that, again, I don't have vision when I walk in somewhere. I don't know how this is going to come together. So our realtor, who's amazing, used a digital staging company.
Yeah.
I didn't even know that was possible.
Yes.
Digitally stage it. I'm like, I want to freaking live there. That looks amazing.
Yeah. And it's very common now. And a lot of designers will even, especially during COVID. So we've all learned the digital staging and digital designing, because a lot of them didn't have jobs. A lot of designers were not working, but they need to keep their portfolios up to date. They need to keep their creative juices flowing. They needed to keep their creativity going. There is incredible 3D design, incredible 3D programs that are so lifelike and so real that you can create a portfolio based on your head entirely. And to your point, you can stage those spaces that you're trying to sell and they look perfect. And you've spent one lump sum, get it done. You don't have all this extra furniture. You don't have to rent furniture. Stagers are getting into this process because there are people who obviously don't want to walk around and see, they want to see what you've done. There's some people that aren't as digitally savvy. They need to actually walk through the space and feel it. So if the furniture isn't there, okay, that's one thing. So it depends on your buyer. But for a lot of stagers, they're learning this process as well so that they can help, move the process along in a digital way as well.
So cool.
It is so cool. Super.
How do you help people design on a budget?
Well, you touched on it a little bit earlier. So it's almost like the outfit. We joke when saying you've got the Target underwear and the Gucci dress, or you mix and match and decide what it is that one expensive piece is going to be, the bag, the shoe, the whatever it is it's going to show, your Target t-shirt with your super expensive Louis Vuittons or whatever. So the same thing with a room. You kind of can pick and choose. I won't name them, but I have seen some, Architectural Digest designers that are on the top 100 put in a piece of IKEA here and there to save on a look so that they can splurge on other things. So the most important thing that a designer needs to do is get the budget from their client. It doesn't matter what the budget is, just get the number. Because then we can work and actually start doing what I just said, figuring out what needs to be the expensive thing, figuring out what we can fudge on a little bit, you know, figuring out what you are not going to see, like the sink, Maria.
Yeah.
You're not going to focus on and what you are going to focus on. And then we control that narrative. And this is what you're going to focus on. And here's where I'm going to spend the money. Or if you walk into Lamps Plus Outlet and see that they have incredible things for very inexpensive, because I know I love them and use them for years. Then you already know that that's not something I'm going to have to spend a bunch of money on. Then I can put it here, put it there. And that's the best way to design on a budget. I wouldn't say go crazy. You know, everything is inexpensive, because then it tends to look that way, right? Mm-hmm. You have to mix and pick out the things that you've created. Like, I'm going to spend money on the rug. I'm going to spend money on the art, and I'm going to spend money on the Hermes throw. Right. So now I have created the focal points and what that narrative looks like. And then the rest of it can be wherever you decide, you know, within a certain budget. But now, you know, here's my budget. Here's the things I'm going to spend money on, the focal points. And then the rest of it can be brought in from outlets or antiques, which is what I'm dealing in now here in Europe. I can't say use antiques enough, honestly. Even my own home, I've got a mix behind me of a Victorian chair mixed with some modern pieces, right? So you get the bang for the buck on those focal points, and you create the narrative. So your budget is intact.
I want to say this for our listeners and our viewers. One of our most wealthy friends, who is, they do their own designing and construction. It brings them together as a couple. They do it very well as a team. But what I find fascinating is that she does exactly what you said. And I mean, this is probably the nicest house I've ever been in LA. And I will tell you, to the left is this like very rare piece. And then to the right is something literally from Target.
Right.
And it was so inspiring. And she was like, oh my God, no. You know, Barbara Lee. She's like, Kevin, no, like don't think like that. Just whatever looks nice. Yes, you can have your featured pieces, but no, I round out all the time. Things from Target, things from TJ Maxx, things from IKEA. And it's really like, it kind of just gives the rest of us, that lets us breathe and say,
yeah,
you know, I can do this. So I love that. I do want to hear more about antiques, because I know antiques is slippery. I'm a history major, so I love that whole area. And I feel like every piece has a story. But I also know that you can really get raked over the coals.
Yes.
Right, with antiques. So I want to hear about antiques.
Yeah, because what do we really know about them, generally speaking, right? Somebody behind a counter saying, this is so rare. Give me all this money.
I was always in the world a little bit. My mom is a huge buff, and she used to drag me to all the antique auctions as a kid. And I hated it until she enticed me with the Victorian keys with a little tassel hanging off. And she told me, somebody used to own this, and they put something really valuable in this drawer. And then I was in, I was hooked. Wow. I was done. I was like, oh, this is fantastic. Yeah. And I used to go and wonder. So fast forward, here I am in the world of antiques. I work for a technology platform that helps antique dealers sell online. So we help them get their products online to multiple marketplaces. So I've been entrenched with some of the most incredible dealers and things that I love. And like you, Kevin, the story kills me. Like, yeah. I die for the story. When I see something, a piece, and the dealer will give me the provenance, and he'll tell me, this is where it came from, and this is the story, and this is why. And what's important about antiques, and you are correct, you can definitely be raked over the coals. But what is important is finding people that you trust. And the other thing that I think is really, really important is they are not always expensive. In the States, we think of antiques as so expensive, you know, like this big car, overly heavily carved armoire, and it's going to be, you know, 30 grand for whatever this piece is. And I can tell you, I could rattle off a list of websites and marketplaces where I have gone on and gone through, and I've seen the most beautiful pieces, and they are the same price as the most affordable websites. I'm like, if I was going to go to Wayfair versus the antique piece, or XYZ store, very inexpensive XYZ store, and the same or similar, but this unique, well-built, beautiful piece of furniture for the same price.
Kelly, can you mention some of these websites?
I'm happy to. If you love mid-century modern, go to thehuntvintage.com. If you love little trinkets and things that are decorative, go to the decorativecollective. thehoard.com. If you want to go less expensive and you want accessories, go to The Hoard. I mean, and then obviously First Dibs is going to be your very high end, and that's how they started and that's what they're known for. So if you're looking for more high end pieces, you would go to First Dibs, and then you can drill down within First Dibs and find really high end deals, like really high end dealers. And then people who are dealing with everyday people who just want to put in something that's unique and beautiful and well-built. And what I found, Kevin, is that we've got a lot of young buyers now who don't want the same thing that all their friends have. Mm-hmm. Oh. They want a story. They want this piece that came from XYZ. They want something that looks different. They don't want the, you know, Page Two or the big box stores, you know, the vignette that you saw in the front window of the mall. They don't want that. Yep. They want something different. And they're finding that what the biggest thing is that recycling and reusing is such an important narrative right now for all of us.
Yeah, good point.
Massive, right? So
and the antiquing helps that. And
antiques are green.
And I like the websites because more than likely there's probably more accountability and authenticity with the pieces, because I know that, you know, sometimes, again, they can be shady where you don't really know where things come from.
Well, right? If you're looking for, you know, I want French provincial, you know, writing desk that made it through a particular war, you better be very, very selective in your dealer. But if you're just looking for something pretty that is in within your budget, that is different and unique, and again, recycling is a big part of your story and what you want in your own home, I encourage you to spend. You'll fall into a hole, Maria. I mean, you'll just be like, I love this and I love this.
I love old stuff. I love old homes. And you know, when we're in Connecticut, we go over to Putnam and we go to the antique antique stores. And I love all the old stuff. I do.
And there was all these old bar lights too, which is very cool. Like if you have a man cave or a home bar.
Yeah.
And so Kelly, can you talk about some of the local antique shops? Because I feel like some of them you can get bargains, and I think some of them I've gone into, I'm like, wait, what? Like, that's crazy. So is there any way to vet them?
No. I think it's so funny because obviously my job now is helping these little antique dealers get online, because they learned in 2020 that they had to, right? Their doors were closing. So a lot of them needed to do that, but, no, you really have to do a little bit of homework. Again, if you're looking for something specific, you could go to the Rose Bowl at 5 a.m. if you really wanted to be the guy who finds the piece first, right? Because you always know that the dealer got it from somewhere, right? They found this piece somewhere and they buy from each other. I've learned so much, you guys. I was like, where did you find this piece? That's what I want to know. I want to go to that place.
Where
did you buy that thing, the thing? And most of the dealers will actually have their own niche, right? So they'll have a specialty. And that's important too. So once you get to know these people and you go, okay, this guy specializes in this, this lady specializes in this, this is what they focus on, then they become so passionate about their collections and where they buy things and the authenticity of those things, that, and they're not crazy, right? They're not going to be crazy priced. Like, I am dealing with a great woman right now, Collier Antiques in the UK. And she's got these beautiful Victorian decanters, Maria, you would love them, for like the bar. And they're £20 each. Like, she's just, you know, here, what do you want? They're stunning. Victorian, 1820. Here's the thing. Here's the weight of them. You couldn't buy these going to a store right now if you wanted to anyway for the amount of money. And then they've got history and a story and where she found them. And I just can't get enough of it. I love the history too. So I mix, as you can see behind me, even, right? I've got some pieces that are from some of the stores that I've been to and some of the dealers. And then I've got some new pieces and Victorian chair and modern this. And you have to mix and match to edit to match your budget.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
One of the things that I popped into my head before we run out of time, I want to ask you about is, how important is feng shui when designing?
Yes.
Was that like a fad, or is that just like really important?
No, I think there are people that really, really, they believe it. It's actually, it's a mindset, right? So it's like anything. If you believe in your meditation in the morning and that it helps you get your head straight and it's the way that you start your day, then that it's personal, right? So feng shui is very personal. So if you think the water feature at the front of your door is what makes your life function and flow and everything stays on track, then gosh darn it, keep that water feature there. But for me, some of the principles are not practical for me because it's very color specific. You need to have a red room in a certain quadrant of the house. And for me, red is the color of energy. And what if that quadrant in the house happens to be my yoga room, hello, or the baby's room? Yeah. Like, I'm not going to have a red room. So it depends on how much you want to take from those principles and apply them. But in general, there are things that you and I would not feel good about anyway. So as an example, you don't want your stairs to end right at your door and flow right out their front door, right? Yours don't.
Ours in Connecticut do.
What is that?
In Connecticut, our stairs lead right out the door. Right. I mean, it's half out the door. It's the window next to the door and the door, but it is.
Most people don't like the way that feels. Yeah. So they feel like the energy flows right out the house.
Yeah.
So as soon as you open up the door, all of the function of the energy of the home goes right out. Some people don't like that. A placement of where you sit, right? Your back to the door, or you don't put your headboard at the back of by the door, right? You don't make yourself feel exposed. That's all feng shui, but it's also things that make sense to us.
Yeah.
So there are things that, you know, we can apply that would make sense, and some things I don't necessarily subscribe to, but again, it's so personal.
I like that. It's like religion. Like I am Greek Orthodox, but there are certain things where I'm like, okay, this doesn't make sense to me. And I'm cool with not having to, you know, do this part of this or yeah. So right. I like that. Kels,
Maria,
the every girl here, I want to make sure you have an opportunity to ask Kelly something.
You literally just read my mind.
I do that.
We're on the same wavelength here.
Kelly, how much time do we have with you?
As much as you want.
Okay, because what I'd love to suggest is, is I would love to take this into another part. Is that possible, Maria?
Yeah.
Where I know you have, you know, and I would love, I have a lot of questions about small spaces, apartments, smaller houses.
Yes.
That's what I know she was going to go into, and I would love to take that to another part with you, Kelly. I'd also like to talk about how you can go to the thrift stores and rehab different furnitures and things like that, and decoration. How do we decorate on a dime? And I know all of that stuff, you know.
Okay.
So I would love to touch on that in another part.
Great.
Si possible.
Let's do it.
Right?
It is. Okay. Es posible. Si.
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 And by the way, like, you know, my goodness, there's a whole other story in the fact that you lived in America all this time and just up and went to Spain.
Oh, that's my alarm.
I sure did.
Right? And I think that's really inspirational and timely because I know a lot of people who are just like, you know what, America, the hustle and bustle, the strain, the pressure. I want to just go to Europe and smell flowers.
Yeah. I do know a lot of people that are doing the same thing, looking into either part-time living or we call it expat living, right?
Yeah.
I have a lot of friends that are like, okay, I'm doing it. I'm finally buying that villa in you name it, Portugal, Greece, you know, wherever they want to go. Then they're ready to.
I have friends even sending me apartments that in Italy that are so inexpensive, like $800 a month for these beautiful places with the, you know. So anyway, I think there's a whole other story in that, if you don't mind.
I love it. Well, hold that thought. I want to hear Kelsey's question, and then I will probably jump out after that.
Kel, my question is, I'm like, let's do this. When you guys were talking about lighting, I was like, ooh, yeah, my room. And I feel like most apartments are like this. We don't get a ton of light. And so I have my, and also, I don't know if this is just my apartment, but I feel like a lot of the apartments in LA don't have the big lights on the ceilings.
The canisters or chandeliers?
They don't have any. They usually don't have any overhead lighting whatsoever.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually.
So it's like I do my makeup, but I have to go back and forth between the bathroom and then my room, and then the bathroom's too orange, and then I'm like, get in the car, and I look like, I'm like, what the heck? So what's like a cheap but also fun, chic, like lighting, or what could I do to my room, or what could we all do to our rooms?
Well, don't be afraid of, and this is where, you know, the Lamps Pluses and the IKEAs come in, but don't be afraid to hang lighting on the ceiling, right? So we're just talking about a simple S hook here. We're talking about a simple little ceiling hook.
Yeah.
And I love doing pendants in the bedroom, pendants over the nightstands, hanging overhead lighting. You need to have a balance, right? Because you can't always have floor lamps in every corner. You can't, if you don't have the table space to put a table lamp, then what do? Don't be afraid of hanging inexpensive and light, right? Because we can't tear up the walls. You can't tear up the ceilings. You can't do any of that. I literally am renting a 3-story place here in Barcelona, and I have no overhead lighting except for a couple cans. So I did the same thing. But I literally went to the store, found some lights that I could, they were hardwire. I changed them to plug in.
Wow.
And I hung them from the ceiling. Swagged it, put some chain on the swag, hang them down. It
looks so smart.
Legit. Yeah. Looks legit built in.
So it comes down to buying a plug, something that has a plug attached, putting a hook in the ceiling. And if not, converting something over, which you can find people to do it, I think for under $100, you know, just to convert it to a plug in. And then you can take it with you too, when you move.
I have another solution, by the way, too. I just sent you a picture because I was looking, I knew Ashley had done something. So she did this like light up mirror, but there's also tabletop makeup. There's a company that Ashley had told me about.
I know.
It's like the vanities.
Yeah. It's like a little tabletop vanity that you can also put your makeup, I think, in the first drawer, and then you open it and you've got your light. So you can go anywhere in your house and have it, and you have good lighting.
Yeah. No, that's smart. Cause it's crazy. I mean, when you said all the, like, I have like 3 standing awkward lights. I'm like, this is horrible.
Yeah.
And it still
is. It is weird. And it sometimes they cast the light up or down. My rule is with floor lamps that they are decorative, right? For me, they're never a functional light ever. I've never found one that I can put in the corner and actually make it a functional light. Really? Because what are you going to do? You're going to put one right next to your closet, and then you're going to put one, like, you know, you need light.
And you're going to be angling it.
Right. No, it doesn't work. So no. For me, find a floor lamp that's really cool in a corner that's pretty dead. Like, if you look in a corner and go, tree or lamp, and it's a dark room, put the lamp in and make it cool. Make it gold lined interior, taller than it should be, bigger focal point. That's your opportunity to do something cool. It doesn't have to be expensive. I literally got mine on Amazon and it's awesome. Kick ass.
And Kelly, just side note, you can put the fake plant in there with a small little spotlight inside the plant.
What?
Ooh. Oh, and you can do that, Kevin. You can uplight.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, nice, right?
Maria, you looked at him like,
because I was thinking of a little teeny plant and I'm like, that's so weird.
You get the best of both worlds.
Yeah.
You can uplight a lamp and create a focal point, right? But don't ever count on a floor lamp to really give you light.
Kev, are you taking notes for us?
Oh my goodness.
I gotta wrap this show so you guys can start the new show. But one last thing, that tabletop makeup mirror thing. Do you know a brand that...
Not off the top of my head, but I can send you if you want a link or something like that. So we can put links in.
Okay. And you can also ask Ashley Daniels because she had them. And I think, why don't you show her that light that I just sent you, that picture? She did it for like $10. I think she made it herself. She had one of those little
we'll put it on that Better Together with Maria, our Instagram page. Yeah. We'll put up the picture along with the description and where you can get it. And if we can, if we get the link, we'll put the link in the the show notes.
And even for people who are not, if we're talking about the budget, we'll go into this next, but IKEA helped me furnish my children's charity apartment complex. So I love plugging them whenever I can because they were amazing.
Oh, that's so cool.
I know. No. I redesigned an entire apartment complex for children with life-threatening diseases and their families. And IKEA gave us everything.
Wow. Everything. So that's amazing.
Yeah, I love them. But they always said they have those light kits. They actually sell the strip lights and you can light up behind your TV set.
Yeah, so that's what I was just saying. There's a stand-up mirror that our friend Ashley put the lights all around. Yeah. So she had it.
So cool.
Yeah, it actually looks cool too. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up. For updated and relaunched, or you updated and you relaunched the Design Psychology Coach Program.
Yes, I did.
And the coach program is going to teach people
how to apply design psychology to their own home so that they are creating havens and understand why they're doing it.
Yeah. And it's working in the trauma-informed design space that we talked about.
Right. Well, that's actually totally different. So we can go there another time, but trauma-informed is just a specific designing for people who have been through trauma, but it is very similar. So I'm creating that program and I also have a design psychology program, but all of it's on my website.
I didn't realize they were two separate things. That's actually really important because I don't know many people who are listening to this who have not dealt with trauma. That's part of our like foundation at this point. Right. So it's really, really great to know that you can coach people through how to make their space feel better so that they can get better.
It is actually creating healing spaces. I am working with a trauma institute and therapists. We are creating a full-blown, it's already part of my design psychology program, but they contacted me and said, we want to make this a thing and we're calling it trauma-informed design. So I can't wait. I'm beyond excited. Yeah.
That's incredible.
And just a little tease in part two, we are going to talk more about the trauma.
Kevin's like, hold on, I have something else to say.
I gotta
wrap the show. I know. No, you're right. This is what we're going to talk about in part two.
We're going to talk about how to decorate for trauma as well as how to decorate for smaller spaces and things like that.
Okay. KellyEllis.com. KellyEllis.com. For all of that, you can find her on Instagram at designer Kelly Ellis. And Kelly, I love you.
I love you
too. Thank you for all you do for us. You've kept a marriage alive during moments when I wanted to flee and pretend him and even my parents and my dogs didn't exist.
My pleasure. I love you both.
And so
stay tuned for part two.